Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. This morning, I'm going to be talking to us about the message titled, The Zeal of God. The Zeal of God. And I need to let us know the significance of a zeal. Because if you do not know what this is all about, you're just going to hear the message and then just go home without really, really having the application of it in your personal life. When we talk about a zeal, we are talking about an embossment, an embossed emblem, a figure, a symbol, or a word that is used as an attestation or an evidence of authenticity. When we talk about a seal, we're talking about a stamp, a medallion, a ring that is engraved with such a device for impressing on something. Now, kings in those days, they use seal. And kings today, presidents of nations, they use seal. You must have seen the seal of the United States of America. And when, as a corporation, you write a letter, it is not considered as authentic and real as when you have your company's seal on that letter. When you are going to do some things in government places, they require that you get that letter or document notarized with the seal of a public notary on it. Not that alone. When you get into the military, and then you have the soldiers, you have the Air Force, you have the Navy, there is a group of people in the Navy that are referred to as the SEAL. Now, to get to that is wanting to be a naval officer is another thing to be a SEAL. For you to get to that point, you must have gone through some rigors. You must have gone through certain experiences. They are considered, the SEAL in the Navy are considered the best of the best. And I am here today to tell you that the people of the world that are using all this SEAL, they got it from the scripture. If I may take you back a little bit to the Old Testament, take for instance in Babylon. When there is a decree, it is sealed. And then when you now get to Media and Persia, once the king signs something with his seal on it, not even the king can alter that thing. Seal is that powerful. And I am here to let you know that everybody, whether as a corporation, as a nation, as a king, or whoever you may be, that is now using seal, it is borrowed from the language of God. Because it originated from God. What am I talking about? All this earthly seal regarding our relationship with the Lord. What I'm talking about today is, it's not enough for you to say, I am a member of any particular church. It is not enough for you to say, I am born into a Christian family. It is not enough for you to say, I bear a Christian name. As a matter of fact, it is not enough for you to say, I am this or that in any church without the seal of God upon your life. It is not enough for you to say, I'm a believer. Yes, because a lot of people may claim to be Christians, they may claim to be believers, and yet without the seal of God in their life. Turn with me very quickly your Bible to the book of Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19. And you will get a better picture of what I'm talking about. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19. It says, nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, Having this, what is the next word? Having this seal. Having this confirmation. Having this assurance. Having this security. Having this approval from the God of heaven. Having this seal. The Lord knoweth them that are his. And let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Here the Apostle Paul is telling us that in order for you to be recognized by God, in order for you to be approved by God, in order for you to be secured by God, you must have this seal. It is a must for every believer. It's not just a matter of we say how many people want to give their life to Christ and you raise up your hand, that is good. But after you have raised up your hand openly, after you have confessed openly or publicly or secretly, the kind of life you begin to live thereafter will determine whether you're going to be qualified for the seal or not. It's not enough to be called a member of the Deeperlife Bible Church. It is only a denominational name here on earth. There is no denomination in heaven. Somebody say amen. It was one of the early Puritans, John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist Church, with all his holiness preaching, with everything. And he got to a point in his life that he believed that by all that he has done, all of his labor, all of his effort on his congregation, that they all will make it to heaven. He made the big mistake. Because God knows those that are really serving him. God knows those that have the seal of God upon their life. God knows those who are really terror to the kingdom of darkness. God knows those who are Christians on the outside but sinners on the inside. God knows those who are pure within and without. He knows everybody. He knows you. No matter what you do in the public, no matter what you do in the church, how about the things you do in the secret? How about the state of your heart? God sees everything, knows everything, understands everything. And so, the Apostle Paul is telling us that the foundation of God's standard is sure. Nothing can change it. Your money cannot change that foundation. Your service or sacrifice cannot change that salvation, that foundation. It's unchangeable. You either belong to God or you don't belong unto him. And so, John Wesley eventually got a revelation. God gave me a dream, a beautiful dream. And he found himself in heaven. I pray you make it to heaven. And he found himself in heaven and he saw the angels of the living God. And he saw the glory of heaven. And he saw the worship of God by the angels of God. Everything glorious, everything wonderful. And then he was so happy and he began to ask the angel, where are the Methodist people, the members of the Methodist church? And he was told, you're looking for the Methodist church members? And an angel said, follow me. And then he followed the angel. He followed the angel. Eventually, they walked out of heaven and they got to a place. It was the gate of hell. And right from the pit of hell, he could hear the screaming, the agony, the crying, the wailing of the members of the Methodist church. I pray you will not serve God in vain. They believed in their church. They believed in the teaching of the church. They believed in the public life of the church. But they had no personal encounter with the Lord. Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal. The Lord knoweth them that are his. The Lord knoweth them that are his. If you really belong unto God, the Lord knoweth them that are his. If you belong to the kingdom of darkness, the Lord knoweth them that are his. Your service in the church does not and will not qualify you for heaven. The Lord knoweth them that are his. You know, Jesus gave a parable. The parable of the wheat and the tares. And the field was there. And the wheat was planted. But all of a sudden, it became clear that there were tares growing up together with the wheat. And the disciples, they said, Master, the owner of the vineyard planted the wheat. How come the tares? Let us go and uproot everything, uproot them. And the master said, no, don't uproot them. I pray you not be a tear. Don't uproot them. Leave them. Let them grow together until the day of harvest. When the wheat will gather into the barns and the tears will be separated and then consumed in fire, that will not be your lot. There are people in the church today. Maybe they are even workers in the church. Maybe they are leaders in the church. Maybe they got so close and familiar with the church and they've been so long in the church to the point that they became leaders in that church. And by virtue of their being around for quite a while, they know all the church dogmas. They know all the doctrines. They know all the rules, all the regulation. Before you quote Genesis chapter 1, they're going to tell you the next verse. Before you say the book of John, they're going to tell you the next. When you talk about salvation, they tell you step 1, step 2, step 3. When you talk about Holy Ghost baptism or sanctification, they will tell you everything. They are good teachers. They are eloquent, but they have not the seal of God. No. They have not the seal of God. And the Lord is saying, leave them. Some will be saying, some, this one in the church, Pastor, why don't you learn that one out? No. Jesus said, leave them. Leave them. When the day of harvest comes, the day of judgment, when the master himself will separate between the sheep and the goats, between the wheat and the tare, between the sealed and the unsealed, when there be no turning back, leave them until that very day. I pray it will not be too late for you in Jesus' name. As we talk about the seal, this seal of God is not something that is external. Like the earthly seal I mentioned earlier on. It is something eternal. It is something that is planted by the Holy Ghost. The Bible says, the Spirit of God beareth witness with our spirit that we are the sons of God. Listen, listen. If you have not gotten to that point in your life, that you have that evidence within you, you have that assurance within you, you have that confirmation within you that no matter what happened, no matter what did not happen, no matter the challenge, no matter the crisis, no matter the wind blowing, no matter the storm or the turbulence, that there is that assurance that you are a child of God, you are not there yet. You're not there yet. And you need to come afresh and forget about the years you have spent and then say, Lord, here am I, just as I am. Just as I am. And if you will come genuinely, he will receive you. I said he will receive you. Romans chapter 2 verse 29. Romans chapter 2. And see what the scripture says concerning this issue also. It says, but he is a Jew which is one, inwardly. Inwardly. And circumcision is that of the heart, in the spirit, and not in the letter, whose praise is not of men, but of God. There are people in the church looking for the praise of men, looking for the acceptance of men, looking for the applause of men. The scripture is telling us that your circumcision, your acceptance, your sonship, your relationship with the Lord is not just in the physical, but inward. But inward. Deep down within you, who are you? Everyone who has received this seal knows it. If you have it, you know it. Because the Spirit of God will confirm with your spirit. I have been to places where I don't understand their language. And yet, when I meet a believer, there is something in them that will click with my spirit. There is something in my spirit that will click with their spirit. And I have told you, I've been to a place whereby the spirit operating there was a strange spirit. And immediately, because I have the spirit of God and they have another spirit, they couldn't contain it. Because light and darkness cannot cohabit together. It's impossible. And I am praying for as many that are desirous of that seal today, they will get it in Jesus' name. It is good for you to check it up. How is my life? Examine yourself. How that Jesus Christ is in you. The scripture says, know ye not yourself except ye be reprobates. As a matter of fact, there are many places in the Bible where the scripture talks about this seal. This seal. We are told that God has put a very special seal on the people that belong unto him. According to what Paul tells us in Galatians chapter 6. Galatians chapter 6. I'm looking at verse 17. Galatians chapter 6. Verse 17. I want you to look at them so you can underline them yourself in your Bible. It says, from henceforth. From henceforth. Let no man trouble me. For I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus. When you have the mark of the Lord upon you, you are free from all alarm in Jesus' name. The book of Ezekiel in Ezekiel chapter 9 verse 4 also makes us to know that those who fear God and walk in righteousness were given a seal on their forehead by the angel of God. By the angel of God. Listen to this. If you are a child of God, there is a mark of God upon your life. The devil recognizes it. The angels recognizes it. Listen to this. Listen to this. When God was about to wipe out the firstborn in the land of Egypt, he told the Jews to put a mark on the lintel of their house. It's a mark of the blood. And God said, when I see the blood, I'll pass over you. That is why Christ had to come and die. That was symbolic. And upon your forehead, there is a mark there right now. You can't see it. I can't see it, but heaven can see it. The demons can see it. The forces and the powers of darkness, they can see it. And when they see it, they take cognizance of it. And they know you are untouchable. You hear what I said? They know you are untouchable. It is at that point that the Bible says that no weapon that is formed against you shall prosper, because the seal of God is there. It is at that point that the Bible says that the angels of the Lord encamp round about them that fear him, because you have the seal of God upon your life. But if you are the type that is playing game, you are playing religion, you are playing church, and you don't understand the difference between religion and righteousness, I pray it will not be too late for you in Jesus' name. Revelation chapter 7. Revelation chapter 7, I look at the fourth verse there. There the apostle John also talked about the seal. It says in verse 4, 7, 4. And I have the number of them which were, what's the next word? Sealed. 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 And there were sealed 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel. The people that were sealed. So, is it real that people could be sealed? Yes, that's why I gave you all these instances. What then is the reason for the seal? All I've given you is just the reality of the seal of God in a believer's life. What are the reasons for the seal of God in a believer's life? Number one, for identification purposes. Identification purposes. So that, number one, heaven will recognize you. Hell will recognize you. Angels will recognize you. Demons will recognize you. It was an act of the apostle when the spirit of the living God was moving in a great and mighty way, and miracles began to happen. Miracles began to happen, and deliverance was taking place, salvation was taking place, healing was taking place. Some got excited. People love good things, and I know you love good things. But then these people, seven sons of Stephen, they felt, well, if Paul could speak and command, and the devils and the demons could obey him, he's a man, we are men. If Paul could lay his hands upon the sick and the sick could recover, he's a man, we are men. If he could do it, is it not just to talk? Oh yeah? And then they came together and they saw somebody who was demonized. If you don't have the seal of God, you better don't go near a demon-possessed person. Because you're going to get more than what you're bargaining for. And they saw a demon possessed individual, and they got the person into a room, and seven of them, and they began to pray, "We command you, we adjure you in the name of Jesus, whom Paul preached." They were even using the name of Jesus. It's not just about using the name, it's the authority behind the name. Hello? Is the authority behind the name that will determine what happens. And they began to pray, "We adjure you." And while they were praying, one person possessed with demon got hold of the seven of them and beat nonsense out of their life. When they realized that if they did not do something, they were going to die, They couldn't go through the door. They had to break the window and begin to jump out. I don't know who among them left last. But whichever one of them left last will never be a normal human being again. Because the Spirit said, "Jesus, I know." The sea was there. "And Paul, I know. But who are you? Who are you? You've been in the church for how many years? Who are you? You sing with us in the choir. Who are you? You usher with us as a worker, as a deacon. Who are you? Oh, when they call a passage of the Bible, you got up and read. Who are you? Yes, Jesus, I know. And Paul, I know, but who are you? I pray heaven will identify you." It's for identification purposes. It's also for protection. is for protection, so that when the wicked one cometh around, he touches you not. Talk to your Bible very quickly. To the book of Revelation chapter 9. That's verse 4. Revelation chapter 9. Verse 4. Revelation chapter 9 verse 4. Verse 4. I want you to get there. Because if you don't understand what we're talking about, I don't want you to just enjoy the sermon. I want the sermon to be part of your life, so you remember for the rest of your life that the seal of God is a must if you must be a child of God. And let me quickly warn you right now. For those of you standing on the edge, whether to be a real, completely child of God or not, listen, if you're going to be cold, you better be cold. If you're going to be hurt, be hurt. The reason is, if you are pretending to be who you are not, you say you are a child of God, you cannot openly, publicly go and commit immorality, and yet you are lusting. You cannot go to disco hall and party with people the way they do, and yet you are enjoying it secretly. And in the middle of the night, you know the kind of movie you watched in your room. You have the cable, and you know the pornography sites that you go. You destroy your body, and you come to church, and you sing Amazing Grace. There is no grace in your life, because it's a matter of time, you're going to be disgraced. When at the end of the day, the devil is true with you, then you realize that you have deceived only one person in your life, yourself. Yourself. Revelation chapter 9, verse 4. And it was commanded that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men, read what follow, which have not the seal of God in their forehead. Destruction awaits the people without Christ. Doom awaits people without Christ in their life. And if all you know in your life is just religion, 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 you have practiced it for this many years, what is the result of it? And yet, the forces of darkness, the powers of darkness, the demons, the evil spirits, even the angels of God, do you know that God judges people? That God punishes? How? In case you don't know, God kills people. The Bible says that our God is a consuming fire. He said, I am God, that is not like me. He said, I hardened the heart of Pharaoh. If you don't want to be hurt, to be destroyed, to be consumed, then you need to understand, you need this seal of God in your life, and you'll get it in Jesus' name. So it's for security, it's for confirmation, it's for approval. That's why Paul said, having nevertheless the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his. Let them that nameth the name of Christ. If you dare name the name of Christ and associate yourself with him, I am telling you, the Bible says, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And this being born again is not just a mouth born again. It's not a national conversion. No, this being born again is not a religious or congregational conversion.